I'm Russ Kikel, and welcome to another episode of American Reef. Today we're heading back out to Mike Paletta's, where Mike's going to be making some changes to his larger reef tank. Before we do that, let's have a word from our sponsors. Just a quick reminder before we head on over to Mike's. If you're watching these videos and you find value in them, support American Reef. How can you do that? Two ways. Number one, you can subscribe to Reef Tutor. Just go to AmericanReef.com, click the Reef Tutor icon, and from there it's a $2 a month PayPal subscription that will give you access to well over 150-ish kind of videos. The ReefKeeping videos, we go behind the scenes at local fish stores, for example. We see how they unpack and order like fish, coral, etc. We see their systems and, you know, their life support systems for the tanks in the stores, for example. You know, the husbandry advice that he gives to his customers. Those kinds of things. Again, well worth that $2 a month subscription. And again, not only does it support American Reef and keep these videos coming, but it also gives you a little behind-the-scenes stuff that you normally wouldn't get. Second way of supporting American Reef is to order high-performance diet, right? American Reef's HPD. You've seen my videos out there for it. Again, it's a food that I've used probably now for about 10 years, and I think it's one of the best fish foods that's out there. Again, the process is simple. Just send me an email at AmericanReef@me.com and, you know, kind of tell you how to order it. And the cost is relatively simple. It's $20. It's $15 for the food itself, $5 for the shipping. You usually get it out within 24 hours. So again, support American Reef one of two ways. Reef Tutor, HPD. That being said, let's take some time now. Let's go see what lessons Mike Paletta has for us today.
What are we talking about today, Mike?
We're going to talk a little bit about lighting. Lighting is one of the more intricate things of aquariums because it's changed dramatically over the last 30 years, where we started off with just fluorescent lights and metal halides that we bought at Kmart that were 5,000 Kelvin. Now you can get 20, 25,000 Kelvin bulbs. And you also have LED lights, which are the be-all and end-all to a lot of individuals right now. They're sort of changing how we're lighting a lot of aquariums, particularly smaller aquariums, where they're not cost prohibitive. On something like this, for the most part, if I lit it with nothing but LEDs, it'd be somewhat cost prohibitive. So that's why I'm still with metal halides. And with metal halides, you have a wide variety of choices. In this instance, I'm now lighting the tank with 14,000 Ushio bulbs because that's what I saw in Sanjay's tank about a month ago. And I was really impressed because even though they're not the 20,000K radiums that I've grown accustomed to, the coloration on his corals was still really brilliant, really dramatic. And the main difference is, looking at it from my perspective, with the blue lights, the corals sort of morph into one another, versus with the 14,000K bulbs, the corals are much crisper and right, stand out more. So there's pluses and minuses. You get faster growth with the lower the Kelvin bulb. 10,000K corals grow much faster than they do under 14K, and they grow faster there than they do under 20K. But the question is coloration. I mean, some people have said what you should do is grow your corals out under 10K bulbs, then when you want to sell them, stick them under 20K bulbs, or when you want to photograph them under 20K bulbs, because you get a lot brighter coloration. So it's a factor of the coloration of the corals, and it's a factor of the bulbs causing more coloration. So there's pluses and minuses to both of that.
Okay, so for the new hobbyist, go over what Kelvin means.
Kelvin is a measure of the color temperature of the bulb. The lower the color temperature, the more it's like 6500K is daylight. Mm-hmm. So that's the color we're most accustomed to. Things will look brighter at 6500K than if you go up above that. At 10,000K, the tank will look a little bit darker. At 14,000K, it'll look a lot bluer. At 20,000K, it's really blue. That's a really blue color temperature. So there's less energy supposedly admitted. That's one of the reasons why you want to use a PAR meter, in that the PAR meter will measure the amount of photosynthetically active radiation. That is, the amount of radiation that the corals can use from each of those different types of bulbs. So you may have a bulb that's really blue, but it may actually have less PAR than a 10,000K bulb. But the blue is being masked by the yellow and green that's being emitted by that lower temperature bulb. So using a PAR meter can help you a lot in terms of how much energy is going to the corals.
Okay, so Kelvin is color, right?
It's color temperature.
And then your PAR is your energy, which they need to live.
Right, photosynthetically active radiation.
Do you have a PAR meter?
In fact, I do. I have an Apogee, which is pretty much the standard most hobbyists have, because it's not overly expensive and it's easy to use, and that's pretty much what we all want.
Okay.
In general, what I do to use this to measure the amount of light coming out of the lights is I put it in what I can find as the brightest spot under the lights, right at the water surface, because the water surface doesn't change, and if I can find the brightest spot, I know it's going to go down from there. Once I found the brightest spot, I log it, then a month later I see where the level is. And what's interesting is typically the lights don't fade gradually. It's sort of an all off a cliff kind of thing. They may drop 2%, 5%, 7%, but whenever they really go, particularly the radiums, they drop really fast. When they drop, there's no denying it.
So it's an on or off. That's
it's an on or off with those, and with this it tells you pretty quickly. But most people think, okay, a PAR meter, that's just for a very advanced hobbyist. That's where they're wrong, because this is very important for beginner hobbyists if you have metal halide lights, in that when you change the bulbs, new bulbs are obviously a lot brighter than old bulbs. If you don't adjust accordingly, you're going to cook your corals and bleach them out. And that's one of the things that happens to a lot of new hobbyists more than anything else. They put in new bulbs, the tank looks great, everything's polyped out for the first 3, 4, 5 days, and all of a sudden stuff starts bleaching, right, and they can't think, well, everything looked great. Well, the reason everything looked great is you suddenly gave all these corals a lot more energy from light. They're using what's in the water, and all of a sudden they start bleaching. So by using a PAR meter, you can equilibrate the lights, that is, move them up or down, adjust the time that they're on accordingly, put something underneath them so that you're the same as the old bulbs were. Typically, I move the new bulbs up an inch or two above. I also put a little bit of shade cloth or something else underneath them, and I cut down on the life on the hours that they're on for the first week or two. Then gradually over the course of approximately a month, I bring them back down to where the old bulbs were until they're at the same level or slightly above. But you're not all of a sudden sending the kid out on the first day that it's sunny after he's been inside the house all winter to get a sunburn. Right. That's basically what you're doing, is sunburning the corals. So that's why you don't want to just willy-nilly put the lamps on the same as they were before. That's where this comes in. So, and if it saves you one or two heads of coral, it more than paid for itself.
Right.
So for a new hobbyist, this is something you probably should consider getting. I know it's not Christmas time, but when you're asking your significant other for a Christmas present, this is something that you won't buy for yourself generally, but it's something you could get.
Okay, so you have metal halides, you move them up or down, right, to basically get the range that you want. And what is that starting range, by the way? In other words, when you put it under there?
When I put it under here, it's around 600, which is the same that most people say is a good reading for an LED system as well. I haven't really tested the LEDs per se, because they're just blue and they're supposed to last forever, but that's one of the things now that I'm getting more into testing things on a more continuous basis. I'm going to see how much those diminish over time, because these have been on for approximately a year and they're about the same as they were before. They're only down about 2% from where they were originally. But that may be just be user error too.
Sure. So, well, it's okay. Okay, so again, halides, your raiser or lower to get your 600s.
Right.
And your LEDs, same kind of thing, meaning that's when, because some of these LEDs are putting out way more than 600.
Right, and the light from the LEDs is focused down. The thing that people have with LED lights versus metal halides, when you have metal halides on a tank, they pretty much light up the entire room. When you have LEDs on a tank, they're basically focused like a laser beam down. They're lighting up the tank, so our perception is the tank isn't as bright. It's because there's not as much light coming out of the tank. The light is focused down within the tank. So this will also give you an idea of You can move this throughout the tank. You can attach it to a pretty much anything, a rod or a piece of plastic, move it around the tank and see where your lights are, because obviously things like the chalices want less light and things like the acroporas want more light. So you can adjust the lights. And with LEDs, I mean, with the Kessel spotlights or things like that, you can manipulate them so that certain areas are brighter, certain areas are less light, and accommodate your corals accordingly.
So let's go back to, remember how we talked about the different types of corals and the flow requirements, but what about the lighting requirements for those same exact corals? In other words, what's the rough?
Typically, the thinner, branchier corals require more light. The thinner, flatter corals generally grow at the bottom. They grow thin and flat because they're trying to get as much light as they can. They don't need the bright light because they're going to absorb whatever they can because of such a larger surface area. So chalices, favias, any of the brain corals mm-hmm. that are flat, like the trachophilias or the wellsophilias, they generally do well at the bottom. Scolemias, they do well at the bottom because they don't need that much light. They also should be fed. We'll get into that later.
Sure.
But the thinner branched, the acroporas, mm-hmm. the postulaporas, the styloferas, they tend to prefer brighter light, and they tend to do better higher up in the tank.
So define that. In other words, when you say the flatter ones, is that like 100, 150, 200?
150 to 250 generally do fine.
Okay.
If you acclimate them slowly, you can get them up to where they like 350.
Okay.
But the key with all of this, particularly with light, is gradual acclimation to more light. The corals don't have it. What happens is if you give them too much light, they produce too much oxygen. It's basically turns into like peroxide, and they basically bleach themselves by producing too much oxygen. So that's one of the things you don't want to do is suddenly blast them. Like I said, it's like sending your son on the first day of the sunshine after he's been inside all winter. Suddenly you're surprised he gets a sunburn. Same thing here. You don't want to suddenly blast the corals with brand new light bulbs and burn them that way.
So then for those thinner branchial corals, 4, 5, 6?
Yeah, anywhere above 400 they typically do very well. And they can do well down the lower light, they just typically won't be quite as brightly colored.
Okay.
So, but there's a lot to go into coloration. We're not going to get into that today, but there's a lot of factors that affect a lot of things. Now on the 20K radiums versus the 14K Ushios, I'm running about 50 micromoles lower with this than I was with the 14K. So, you know, roughly 8-9% lower, which is manageable. But, you know, obviously you want to have as much par as you can.
Sure.
But as I said, these look a lot bluer than do the 14Ks. So you'd think you were getting more par, but in reality, all you're doing is lower par, but no yellow and green, so it looks less bright.
Right.
But the question is, you know, which is more appealing to me and which is more appealing to the people that see this tank? And that's the question with light all the time, is how much or what kind of light provides the best? Because in addition to these, I have 3 6-foot Reef Bright Blues above it, which really bring out the tank's colors, particularly the chalices and the large polyp stonies. And unfortunately, you can't pick that up with video.
Right.
But for those of you that have seen pictures of chalices, you have a pretty good idea what it looks like under those lights.
Right.
So it's much, the coloration on the corals is much better with this, though, than it was with the VHO fluorescence.
Right.
So the LEDs are bringing out the colors, or they may be making us see brighter colors, or causing more bioluminescence or biofluorescence. So there's a lot of factors that go into what's going on with the lighting. But as probably the most controversial aspect of reef keeping is lighting, and adding LEDs to the mix now is changing things even more dramatically. Because as I said, Sanjay loves the 14Ks. He gets phenomenal growth. I mean, his corals grow to the surface of the water. They're big, huge, beautiful colonies. Very little bleaching down at the bottom where they're shedding, because he's grown most of them from frags. So in that regard, they're very, very good lights. A lot of people like these lights, particularly if you're photographing or selling corals, because it brings out the colors even more.
Right.
So there's a lot to be said for both. I mean, in my old 1,200 gallon tank, I actually ran a combination of both.
Mm-hmm.
I ran 14Ks and 20Ks in combination, and that way I had the best of both worlds. With this only being a 6 foot long tank, that's really not,
sure.
I mean, unless I went to 250 and put four of those on, but I can't really see those being worthwhile, rather than the 400 watts that I'm running now.
So now, what kind of reflectors are they?
These are the old Luminarcs.
Okay.
First saw these on Sanjay's Penn State tank in 2000.
Mm-hmm.
They basically cause 16 facets of light. That is, if you look at the light from above, it looks like there's 16 metal halide bulbs. And when we ran comparisons, or when he ran comparisons, he roughly found 80% more light with these reflectors than any other reflectors that were out at the time. Because the hot reflector at the time was the spider light. Now there's various incarnations of these, and they all basically do the same thing.
Right.
So these are no longer necessarily the be-all and end-all. But I like these in that, one, I've had them, so I didn't have to buy new ones.
Right.
Two, I got low iron glass to put on here, Starfire glasses in my reflectors, so I don't lose that 1-2% that you do from typically having light. And three, like I said, I now clean the glass once a week.
Sure.
It takes me 5 minutes. Saturday mornings is glass cleaning time, and because I no longer have to clean the tank because of the robo snail, it's 5 minutes now I spend cleaning that. So I've just shifted my time.
And now, you know, again, as far as that salt creep, what kind of par drop did you see, we'll say, you know, clean versus dirty?
It depends on how long the dirty was, because as it accumulates, it just gets thicker and thicker.
Sure.
I could see as much as 60% of the light was lost.
60%. Wow. Okay.
In one, I had the lights a little bit lower, and two, I had even more splash.
Sure.
And three, I was a lot lazier, so I would go 3 months.
Sure.
And then I went with a par meter, and I was shocked at the difference.
Sure.
So whenever I cleaned the glass, I actually had to raise the bulbs. It was like putting new bulbs on
sure.
the tank.
Sure.
So, I mean, the corals didn't complain, but I could tell I was starting to get more shading underneath. I wasn't getting the reflection from the sand.
Right.
So keeping that clean, I mean, it's a simple task. I mean, I don't use Windex or anything because that ammonia is lethal.
Right.
I use a combination of white cider vinegar and rubbing alcohol.
Okay.
And it takes off just about every salt stain there is, or any other kind of stains. And what else is interesting, in the old tank, I used to get bugs used to get trapped
sure.
in there because I had the tops open.
Right.
Now I have them closed and I don't get the moths and other stuff, so I don't have stuff cooking on the glass.
Right.
And they literally cooked on the glass.
Yeah, they did. Okay, so when you say you use alcohol in the apple cider, is it apple cider?
No, cider vinegar.
Okay,
white cider vinegar.
Okay. What's the ratio, water, vinegar, alcohol?
It's probably two parts vinegar to one part alcohol.
Okay.
And if you really want to, you can add a little bit of RODI water too.
Okay.
Probably another part of that to make it more dilute, but I just add that and it works like a charm.
Okay, and you spray it onto a rag and then do it?
I spray it onto a paper towel.
Okay.
Only do it before the lights come on. Don't do it when it's hot, because all you'll do is break the glass or cook whatever's on there onto there.
Okay.
So you'll steam it on. So you don't want to do that. So Saturday mornings at 9 o'clock, the lights come on at 10. I come down there at 9 and clean the glass and start doing testing.
Perfect. And okay, back to your tank now. Do you like the 20K look better? I mean, what do you?
As I'm sitting here looking at it, I do like the 20K look better, but it's not dramatically better. It's better. But the problem is that you can't keep yellows and pinks as well under the 20Ks.
Okay.
They tend to, the yellows turn to greens, everything turns to green.
Mm-hmm.
Purples do well. Stylophores that are red, pink, magenta all sort of fade into kind of a brownish, purplish color.
Right.
So from that standpoint, the 10Ks do provide more contrast in the colors,
sure.
or the 14Ks,
sure.
more contrast in the colors. But overall, I kind of like this effect. I mean, the problem I have is I really like the glowing corals. Like this prism favia down here looks
right.
a lot nicer under the 20Ks, as does the war coral. I mean, but the proof is in the pudding. I mean, Red Bubble Tips has four or five offspring in the tank that it's reproduced over the past year or so. The Yellow Bubble Tips, there's now four of them over the past year. And even the Pink Tip, which is a lot rarer, has produced three offspring.
And is that common, like in what, in a healthy tank or a tank with what kind of parameters?
Typically in a healthy tank, you'll start to get a reproduction of the anemones.
Okay.
I mean, I've never had this kind where usually you get a splitting of the mother into just two daughters.
Right.
Here I'm actually getting them, some of them throwing off babies out of their oral cavity.
Uh-huh.
So I'm getting four and five offspring at a time out of the, particularly the rose anemone. So they produce relatively rapidly, considering like 10 years ago, they were talking about a ban on anemones because they weren't reproducing
sure.
in the wild. Now we find that we can propagate them fairly quickly and efficiently. I mean, because one of the advantages in this tank, there's a pair of clownfish that feed them,
mm-hmm.
and as a result, they grow relatively quickly. By the same token, I'm now getting in some new aquacultured corals. I just got them in from Sustainable Aquatics, who's now doing the same thing that ORA is in terms of aquaculturing rare and nicely colored Acropora.
Sure.
So as a result, I can't wait to see how those do over time, because aquaculture, there's differences. A lot of times the aquacultured corals are aquacultured under sunlight, so they come in and they look kind of beige or brown
right.
with a hint of color, but nobody's going to propagate beige or brown corals.
Right, right.
So it's going to be interesting to see what happens to them under these lights and under these conditions if they color up the way they have in the wild. Because some of the corals that they've sent me, like an Acropora albrohensis and
sure.
tenuis and macrolatus, are some of the most brilliantly colored of the stony corals. So it'll be interesting to see what they look like in 3 months, 6 months, a year.
Sure. Now, as it relates to lighting and like the Acropora, do they also have that kind of fluorescent, you know?
Well, it's interesting about fluorescence in that an article just came out a week or two ago that showed that you can assess the health of the corals by how much they luminesce or fluoresce.
Okay.
So corals that are brightly colored are healthier than those that are pale or washed out or brown, which is sort of what we've known. So under these lights and under the LED lights, especially, for our English-speaking friends especially, you can really see the corals grow and see the health of them based on those lights.
Okay. Now, you were telling me about amino acids before, right? Does that have, amino acids have anything to do with coloring?
They do with the health of the corals, in that corals have one of the largest amounts of their body mass designed for foods and feeding. And one of the ways in which they feed is they absorb things through the water.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that's hypothesized that they feed on are amino acids. So I've played with several different companies' amino acids, and as I said before, I've sort of gone back to the future in that regard, in that I've gone back to Elos's amino acids. They have the highest concentration of amino acids that I could find, in that when I put them in, they will color the entire tank yellow. Versus the other amino acids I put in, they were immediately dissipated into nothing.
Okay.
So I'm going to show you in 1 second what I mean by adding just 30 cc's of amino acids into this tank, how much they'll color up the tank.
Okay.
Yeah, this isn't a whole lot of amino acids. This is roughly 30 cc's of amino acids. And when you pour it in, you can see how it fills the entire tank. So that's a concentrated amino acid.
And now, as far as the benefits?
I've just had more healthy corals when I was feeding amino acids than when I wasn't.
Okay.
So, I mean, that's the biggest thing. I mean, anything I can do to add to the health, overall health and well-being, providing an amino acid source for them. Once a week, they get amino acids. And so once a week, the day after the amino acids are in, is the day I also feed them. So I'm trying to train them that after the amino acids are in, they're usually polyped out anyway. So
sure.
then I feed them food. So it's not really Pavlov's dogs, except that it's a chemical marker to indicate when it's time to feed them or when they're going to be getting food.
Sure.
Now the big things that we're changing, in addition to lights, we're also improving the water flow in this tank. I had been using the Vortec pumps on this tank since its inception, and they had been in use for about 12-13 months, And then they started to make the loud, high-pitched squealing sound, which is not really why I want to sit down here. I have also, after 14 months, both of them died. And to replace them, it's going to cost around $200, $250. So I already have almost $1,000 in the two pumps. To put another $250 in it didn't seem worth it to me. Because the other thing I didn't really like is the flow is nice, but it's all across. Right. There's no real flow in the middle of the tank. There's no real flow behind or anything. So now what I've gone to is something sort of back to the future. 10 years ago or so, I had what I considered the nicest tank I've ever had. It was my 560-gallon tank. I'd moved it from Greensburg to Cranberry, where I lived, hauled everything over, set it up. Most of the corals in there had been grown from little tiny fragments into the size of cantaloupes or basketballs. Some of them were really, I mean, they were beautiful corals, nice coloration, growth, no dead spots, cut everything and grown up in that tank from the spot, so it never got shadowed, it never got shadowing underneath. Everything was really, really impressive. But being always wanted to do bigger, I then built a 1,200-gallon tank, which was nice for a time, but it never matched the long-term success of that tank. And one of the reasons for that is the 560 was a manageable tank. The 1,200-gallon tank was never manageable. Because it was 4 feet front to back, you had to take windows out to climb in the back to work on it. You couldn't work in the sides. It would just took a lot of work, and you couldn't really maintain it the way I like to. And the way most of us reef keepers are, we're somewhat meticulous in what we do. So in that tank, one of the things that I really liked about it, I was using what Ed made were the sea swirls. And now what I'm using are the sea sweeps, which are basically a mover for a power head, and in this case the Tunze power heads, and it causes a much broader sweep of water motion throughout. And in some of the video that we shot, you saw where the tank looked very good where it was. Then we put the Tunzes and the sea sweeps in, and you could see how much detritus it blew out. And the whole goal of having water motion is to blow the detritus away from the corals. It also has an ability to blow a lot of the predators away from the coral. I had less of a problem with flatworms, red bugs, or anything else when I had a lot of current blowing across the corals. I also had much better polyp extension. So that's why I've gone back to the future and gone back into the sea sweeps and the Tunzes. And to me, that's the ticket for getting much better. I know some authors have said you tend to get more turf algae if you have water blowing across. I've never had that as a problem. As long as I keep my nutrient levels down and my magnesium and calcium and alkalinity levels up, I've never had a real problem with that kind of turf algae growing. So for this, I expect to get faster growth, which will hopefully help to reduce some of the reduced growth from going back to the radium. So everything here is a trade-off. Whether I get the rapid growth due to more rapid water motion, which is what I've gotten in the past, I also tend to get thicker coral growth. That is, the corals with low water motion will always be kind of sickly and spindly, versus when you have good strong water motion, you tend to grow thicker branches of coral, which tend to be much healthier. So that's one of the other reasons why I've switched to the Tunzes and the sea sweeps. And I mean, for the money, you're talking about the same money of putting one of those in, of putting a Vortec in, and I think you're getting a much broader spread of water motion. Now it says that the water motion from this is about 1,600 gallons, and when you feel it, it doesn't feel like that much. But when I was talking with Russ a little bit earlier, one of the reasons we feel that's the case is you're going over a broader cross section. 1,500 gallons blowing through a half inch hose feels a lot stronger than 1,500 gallons blowing across an inch and a half interface. So I think you're getting the good water motion, but you're getting it over a broader surface. So you're getting a more gentle flow across. But it was still significant enough to blow a lot of the detritus off of the corals.
So again, we got new hobbyists, right? We know that they know that lighting, feeding, and flow are the key, right, to good coral growth. For you specifically, what are your kind of top three things that you're looking at for flow?
For flow, what I'm looking at is strong flow, but not flow in one spot.
Okay.
As you can see, one of the corals here, one of the power heads had shifted down about a half an inch, and it basically sheared off all the flesh from the coral. So by having the coral, the power head sit in one spot, it took the tissue right off of the coral. So that's the first thing I want. I don't want to cause any damage to the coral. Two, I want to blow off all the detritus that's accumulating and keep it in motion as long as I can. Because as long as it's in motion, it's more likely to get sucked over the overflows down into the filtration system underneath the tank, and it's a lot easier to get out of there than it is out of here. Three, what I want is water flow that I can control. That is, with this, you have a 90 degree. I've been able to adjust this to get the flow exactly where I want it. With some of the other power heads that are just one direction, you can't really adjust it, because whenever I put the other power head here, I'm going to have these blow across each other in a somewhat random fashion. So what's going to happen is when they meet in the middle of the tank, I'm going to get those kind of swirls and eddies that I want to see around the heads. I still have power heads on either side to cause some straight line flow, and that interacts a little bit as well with the tunsies and the sea sweeps. So by having all that mixed flow, the next flow I'm probably going to put is a couple power heads behind the reef and blow all the detritus out from behind it. Because one of the things that's accumulated after a year or so is there's a lot of detritus in this tank. A lot of stuff settles in dead spots, so that's the other thing you want with flow. You don't want to have very many dead spots. Or if you do have a dead spot, you want it to be so you can, when you do your water change, sure, can easily siphon out the detritus.
So now of those three, right, that you just mentioned, what is the top, we'll say, on your list?
Randomness of flow. Something so you don't get a dead spot.
Got it. So randomness, and it's going to keep the solid in suspension until it connects with it.
Right. As long as it's not so strong that it just knocks everything off. Because I've done that in the past, too, with big water pumps on closed circuits. You couldn't put anything within 2 feet of them because it'd knock everything off. With this, it's a very nice flow from my point of view in terms of what I perceive the corals would prefer rather than just that blast of a single line.
Now, you had mentioned something, for example, like what the corals prefer. Obviously, different corals prefer different kinds of flow. Can you go through the different flows that you
The thicker Acroporas, Humillus, Sarmentosa, typically prefer the really, really heavy flow. I mean, they like to be blasted. Right. Then the next group are probably like the Millepores, the Staghorns. They prefer more of the moderate flow. Then in terms of the general flow, it's more the branching Montiperas, the things that the Digitatas that are typically somewhat spindly. Mm-hmm. Now, when you get to some of the LPS, like the Chalices, the Acans, they like a nice gentle flow. They don't really like to get blasted, because what you'll see is the tissue will just rip right off of the surface of the hard coral. So you don't really want strong motion on them. You want some to blow the detritus off them, but you don't want it so strong that it's shearing the tissue right off of them.
So now, in a mixed display, how do you accomplish that? How can you do that with them?
Well, what you do is you adjust your power heads and put them where you want, and you don't have one big massive power head causing all the flow. I mean, the Carlson surge device is really nice for causing a massive wave of flow, and that's a lot of times what the corals are used to. But since I don't really have the space or like the mess or like the air bubbles and the salt creep of the Carlson surge device, right, I go with the power heads. And for me, having the sea sweeps and the tunsies is providing the best of both worlds. It's giving me a broad flow across a broad area. It's not particularly unsightly. I mean, that's the one downside. It's not like a vortex that's stuck on the side of the tank.
Right.
You can see it in the front of the tank, but it's far enough away that it doesn't really detract from the overall look of the tank. And to me, my biggest concern is the health of the corals and the overall look of how the corals look. So I'm not as worried about having a 3-inch ball in the middle of the tank as much as I am how healthy the corals
sure
are.
So again, with the C-sweep Tunzi combination, are you saying it kind of gives you that surge feel where it hits it and then goes away?
By running two of them, yes, okay, because they'll be flowing at different times, and occasionally they'll run together. And when they run together, the amount of water motion they're doing is going to increase in one spot and cause some randomness within the tank. I don't want them blowing so that they go like this. It's more like this,
right,
so that they interact with one another in a somewhat random fashion.
Now, what if you put like a controllable power head on there? I know like the Tunzi has to control.
That would even be better, because then you could have one on, one off, both on. You create even more randomness within the system. Obviously, with new technology, whenever we started doing this, which is sad to say, next year will be my 30th year keeping reef tanks, we didn't have any of this stuff. I mean, there were little tiny power heads, there weren't any Tunzis,
right,
there wasn't any of this equipment available. We basically built everything from scratch. So this is making my life a lot easier. And that's one of the other things I'm trying to do in upgrading this tank, is I'm trying to make my life a lot easier. I've done some small things within the tank that are saving me time and saving me effort and letting me sit back and enjoy the tank more than always having to have my hands in the tank.
Sure.
Which is the goal of everyone, is not to have your hands in the tank all the time, but it's part of our nature to have our hands in the tank a fair amount of the time. C-sweep unit is actually pretty simple and pretty easy. Only biggest part is cutting to the tubing here to the size that you want or length that you want. Obviously, you don't want the unit down at the bottom of the tank. You want it as high as up as possible. So I cut it into two sections, actually. Yeah, and you simply run the cord through the pipe, through the threaded pipe. Ed has cut this, so all you need to do is put a screwdriver in to open it up. Slide this up and in. And that way you're not constantly ratcheting the cord and eventually destroying it. There's a cut through there. Just run it through. Run this up through the unit. And there's a hole in here that you line up. Tighten it down, pull your cord all the way through.
Kind of screw that base on together, is that the idea?
Yeah, you screw the base and you don't over tighten it again. Now all I'm going to do is install this last one. I've made two major changes to this tank in terms of lighting and water flow, both of which I think will make significant improvement in the tank. I'm adding a few other little nuanced things besides making it easier to maintain and easier to take care of. And in the long term, I think this will have much better results and I'll get to enjoy it more. And isn't that the whole point of the hobby? Having fun and enjoying it rather than working and worrying that you're in a competition. So enjoy the hobby and hopefully I made you all successful so you'll give me frags someday.
And we'll come back in about 2 months and we'll see how the changes affected the thing.
Unless everything's dead, in which case you won't see me again.